Are you ready? Are you ready, ready? Everybody wave at Rick and Gwen Gorel. Visitors from afar, good welcome home. Did you park your trailer here permanently or are you still mobile? So, I'm sorry. We are glad to see you this morning. Glad that you came to be a part of worship with us here today. If you're here this morning with us as a guest, bless your heart in a good way. And that was the good way, right, Randy? Bless your heart in a good way. And we're glad that you're here. If you take a guest card from the pew pocket in front of you and fill that out, there is a drop box there in the back. You can put that in there so we'll know that you've been here and we can send you some info about our church through the mail this week. Members, that's the same drop box that you would use to drop your offering in if you brought that with you today. A couple things to highlight for you out of your announcements. We had 252 folks studying God's Word last week on Labor Day weekend, which is awesome. So we're excited about that. And go ahead, clap. That's all good. That clap and get you warmed up for worship here in a minute. So tell your friends to come and join you. The boogeyman does not live here, but God does. So come and join us for Bible study. Tonight at 5:30 p.m., what starts? Awana. All right. So Awana starts back up tonight at 5:30. Also adult discipleship training and youth life groups. So we'll get back into our fall role. Tomorrow night at 6, right here in the sanctuary, we have our church-wide prayer meeting. Would you agree that our country needs a little prayer? I think we can all agree on that. So we work on agreeing about other things. So come join us tomorrow night at 6 for that. Read the details there in your bulletin. Today, down in the fellowship hall, there will be a table down there, a couple tables down there, but one of them has information about Compassion International at it. John Thomas will be down there manning that. You can go get more information about that wonderful ministry, how bringing kids out of poverty around the world, and if you choose to, you could even adopt a child to help be a part of that. So stop by there on your way around the building this morning. There's a lot of other good information in your bulletin. I encourage you to read that and take advantage of those things. Right now, we are in the middle of our Partners in the Harvest emphasis. That is our yearly focus on missions. You'll note in your bulletin this week there is a brochure about Missouri missions and the week of prayer for that. I think today, day one, is about inmates becoming missionaries to those that they're incarcerated with. So as you do go through the week, just read those stories, but do more than just read. Pray for those things, those needs that are listed there. I encourage you to do that. But our church is a part of missions literally around the world, here locally, in the United States, and in places way, way away from here. So we're excited about that, and we are partners in those ministries through praying, like we're doing this week with Missouri Missions, through going, because many of our folks do go and are active, and we would encourage you to look in those opportunities, but also through giving. And that's a part of what our Partners in the Harvest emphasis is about. Our goal this year, financial goal for our offering, is $30,000. That goes to international missions, it goes to North American missions, it goes to state missions, Missouri missions, also goes to help fund mission trips that folks from our church take. So I encourage you to pray about your part in that, ask God to share with you what he would have you give above your regular tithe, and then just give that, and we'll get to and above that $30,000 goal, and we're excited about that. Now let's take just a moment. We're going to watch a video on the magic screens, and it shows how that money is used to take the gospel.
I love Pittsburgh. I really do. I love the narrative that makes up Pittsburgh. This is the city that built America and the world. Most people identify themselves with a building or with a religion. What is amazing is when we preach the true gospel, we preach relationship, not religion. We have united here with an army of church planters and wives and families who are together preaching Jesus all over the city. My first call was to plant a healthy, multiplying church here in the city of Pittsburgh. We knew that God was doing something that was bigger than us, and we started to ask ourselves, what could we do towards a citywide vision of seeing churches planted all over the city of Pittsburgh? And God began to open the door for that influence. When you have a team coming together, that's how our cities are going to be changed. And so as we come into the city of Pittsburgh, you have a diversity of backgrounds, a diversity of people, new outsiders coming in, those who've been here generational for years and years and years, Pittsburghers who've gone through the steel industry crash, And in order for us to reach these people, we need a diversity of pastors. Those first 3 to 5 years are really tough for a church planter. And we want to make sure that when a church planter comes into a new city, we try and equip them not just with the friendships, with the brotherhood, with the coaching, but also with the financial resources for them to begin to reach people in their city, because we truly believe we're stronger together. So when people give to missions, it's a game changer. This offering gives those church planters a generosity boost to get that mission up and going. And this generosity is truly changing lives.
If you would, bow your heads and close your eyes and take just a moment and begin to ask God to share with you how you can be a part of taking the gospel to our world through your prayers, through your going, and through your giving. And as you spend that moment, Miss Cheyenne Beale is going to lead us in our prayer.
Pray with me. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you so much for the opportunity to come here and worship with fellow believers. We know so many don't have that opportunity. Help us to give willingly to the missions and help those around the world that need our money. And help us to get something out of Randy's lesson today. And just help us to be safe and healthy wherever we go. In Jesus' name, amen.
I have had this song going through my head all week long. And I thought, I already know Randy's talking about that, so I'm just liking the song. It was a song that we learned when I was a little girl at church. It was a hymn, and it was called "Does Your Anchor Hold?" or "We Have an Anchor." And so that chorus has just been going through my mind over and over. And all day yesterday, I was doing some cleaning, and I just kept that song just kept going through my mind. And so I'm going to read you just a little bit of it. It's, oddly enough, is not in this hymnal that we use here, but it's one that I know that most of us older people are familiar with. And it says, "We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll, fastened to the rock which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love." And then the verse goes on and asks a question. It says, "Will your anchor hold in the storms of life? When the clouds unfold their wings of strife, when the strong tides lift and the cables strain, will your anchor drift or firm remain?" And so then that chorus just keeps coming back. We have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll. And I was reminded of the story in Acts when Paul was on the ship headed to Rome. And they were on the ship for many, many days. And they were it was wintertime, and they were traveling. And the storms were horrible. And the men were getting sick, and they were worried. And Paul just kept telling them, "Don't worry. I know, I trust the God that I worship, the Lord, the God that saves, and we're going to be okay. I know that the ship's going to be destroyed, but we're going to be okay." And then one of the passages, it says that they lowered the anchors, and this is the part that I love, and prayed. They put their anchor down and prayed. So we don't walk around with like this anchor attached to us. We don't have anything that we can throw down. But we can put our trust and our hope and everything that is inside us in that one true God. That same God that Paul prayed to when those storms, and it said it was like a hurricane. Now, how many of you have seen the pictures of the hurricane that just happened a week or so ago in Texas and in the Gulf? And the waters were crashing over. Could you imagine being on a boat and having that kind of water crash over you and being so afraid? I can too. It's kind of scary thinking about it. And sometimes that's how it feels in our life. We get stuff happening, and honestly, all this COVID stuff kind of makes us feel a little weird and shaky inside and not unsure. But we don't have to worry because we have an anchor in Jesus Christ. Jesus is our anchor, and he's going to hold on to us, and we can be just like that, sure and steadfast, because when all of those emotions and all that anxiety and all those yucky feelings that we get come creeping over us, we can remember that Jesus is our anchor. Isn't that a neat thing? Just like Paul. You know what? They ended up shipwrecked, but a lot of good things happened, and nobody was hurt. The ship was destroyed, but not one person was hurt because Paul remembered, and he told him, you have to believe what I'm saying. There's a bigger power, and we're going to have to trust, and that's what they did. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your word that anchors us to you, and thank you so much for the testimony of Paul that we have to read, and for the testimonies of so many people. God, we can look all around us and we could have people after people, even in this room, stand up and say, Jesus has been my anchor during this time in my life. And because of that, we have the hope and the assurance that you're going to do everything that you say you're going to. And that we can put our trust in you, Jesus. And so I just thank you and praise you, and I just ask, God, that you would help each one of us, every one of the children that pass through these doors in this church, that they would know that Jesus is their foundation, that he is their anchor, and he holds them tight, so tightly in the palm of his hand. Lord, we just thank you for all that you do. May our worship be a sweet and pleasant offering to you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, church. Would you stand to your feet as we lift our voices to the heavens?
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. The Lord God Almighty, who was Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You
says, do not love the world or the things in the world, because the world is passing away in it. Whoever is filled and does what the will of God abides in him forever.
Oh, to grace, how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy good I love.
Lord, we pray that's our prayer this morning in worship, Lord, that you would be lifted high above everything else.
You'll take your Bible and turn to Colossians again. We're ready for chapter 2. We've spent 2 or 3 weeks in chapter 1. We're going to move to chapter 2. As we continue to look at these passages, I do want to remind you that we are all partners in the harvest. And as I looked at these verses, it really gave some more perspective in just what that means to be partners. If we're going to be partners, we're going to be concerned about one another. We're going to be concerned about one another's growth and growth in Christ. And when one may be wavering just a little bit, we're going to pay attention to that and be holding them up in prayer. Paul was, again, I remind you, was in prison in Rome when he wrote these words to the church at Colossae and to Laodicea, which was just probably about 6 miles down the road or the path from Colossae. And so he writes this letter to both of them, and he does it specifically that he might encourage their leaders. And so with that in mind, he has got it on his heart that even though he had not been to Colossae, he had not been to Laodicea, even though he did not plant these churches personally, friends of his, leaders, the leadership of these churches did plant them, and he knew those leaders. He still felt like he was a partner with these churches, and it was almost like they were kind of granddaughter church plants of churches that Paul had planted, and he felt a responsibility, much as grandparents feel a responsibility toward their grandchildren. And as you are responsible for your grandchildren, sometimes you get the pleasure of seeing some of those first things that happen in grandchildren's lives. For instance, maybe they take their first step while you're watching them that one evening. And you're there, you're the one that's coaxing them on, and everybody is doing that. Somewhere around 10 months or so, people began to, start encouraging the little ones, if they dare, to get some balance on 2 feet and to start walking. And so you may be the one that's there watching, and you're coaxing them on and watching them, and they take 2 or 3 steps and they fall. And you go over and help them up and encourage them and then start the process over again. Bearing in mind that while your goal is to teach them to walk, that you still carry them a great deal. And as parents raising children, you are going to carry them a great deal through the years. And And you want to be there for them. As your goal is for them to walk on their own, you're still going to be responsible to help carry them. Paul felt that kind of feeling in these churches that he wrote these letters to. And it was really quite a struggle for him. As we read the passage, we'll see that. It was really kind of a struggle for him to be tied in the prison and not be able to go there. But he wanted to pray for and encourage these leaders. Tomorrow night, we're going to be focusing our prayers on the leadership of the church. September is that time of the year that we put new leaders, our Sunday school teachers, our committee leaders, and all our program service coordinators and directors, and so we got them in place. And so tomorrow night, I felt like that it was important that we spend time praying for our leaders. So if you're one of our Sunday school teachers, or if you're one of our committee members, or you have a responsibility, one of our deacons, or one of the WMU, you've got some leadership in the church, and really I can get that so refined that everyone is a leader in the church. I want to encourage you to come because we're going to be praying in our joint worship time specifically for the leaders of the church. And that's going to be the focus of our prayer time tomorrow. So I encourage you to come not only to pray but to receive prayer. And Paul was doing that for these leaders in this church. Let's stand together and read the passage. We'll start with verse 1, Colossians chapter 2. I'm reading from the Holman translation from Lifeway. for I want you to know how great a struggle I have for you. For those also in Laodicea, and for all who have not seen me in person, I want their hearts to be encouraged and joined together in love, so that they may have all the riches of assured understanding and have the knowledge of God's mystery, Christ. In him, all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are hidden. I am saying this so that no one will deceive you with persuasive arguments. For I may be absent in body, but I am with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the strength of your faith in Christ. Therefore, as you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, walk in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, just as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. Be careful that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deceit, based on human tradition, based on the elemental forces of the world, and not based on Christ. For in him, the entire fullness of God's nature dwells bodily, and you have been filled by Jesus, who is the head over every ruler and authority. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the passage of Scripture. And again, we ask Holy Spirit to teach us this morning as we look at it. May we be faithful to your word, and may we gain in knowledge and wisdom. May we grow closer to you, be more rooted and anchored in you, our Lord and Savior. We pray this in your precious and holy name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. And so we read very quickly that Paul uses the word struggle twice. And that word for struggle there is agion, and it means to agonize. When he was praying for these churches, while he was in prison, he literally was agonizing in his heart because he wanted to be there. He wanted to face the false teachers. He had a little bit of Joel Carpenter in him. You know, he wanted to get in the face of those false teachers himself. He had a little punkin to him. You know, he wanted to be there and fight those battles. But as much as he wanted to be there, he couldn't. He was in prison. And so the struggle just wore on in his heart, and so he would continue to lift them up in prayer and pray for God's wisdom so that he could write letters like this one that we love so much, this letter to the church at Colossae and to Laodicea. And he did so. He struggled and he prayed for them because he wanted those people to be anchored solidly into Christ Jesus. Tonight, Becky and I are going to be teaching a course called You and Me Forever. And again, it's filled up. There's not room for anybody else, so this is not an advertisement. But I do want to say this about the course. It challenges us to practice this idea of seeing others anchored in Christ on each other as husband and wife. And in fact, that is, as I said last week, that is really the driving spirit behind the entire book. There's no place greater than right there in your marriage relationship, right there in your home and family, to practice how to see others anchored in Christ. Paul wanted these people in the church at Colossae and in the church at Laodicea, he wanted them to be anchored in Christ Jesus with all their heart, because he knew all of the things that were being said. He knew all of the arguments that were out there. You've heard the term, if you've studied Scripture at all, Gnostic or Gnosticism. There were Gnostics out there who were telling half-truths. And Paul did not want those half-truths to get mixed in with the church's teachings. To teach something halfway is to teach something falsely. And so they were false teachers that he would love to take on himself. But he wanted these people to learn to stand up and to be able to fight those battles. And so they needed to be anchored in Christ Jesus. They needed to be anchored in several ways. As you look at the scripture, he prayed first that they would be joined together in love. One of the things that is so vitally important for a church fellowship is that we're anchored in the love of Christ, because we're going to have disagreements and we're going to have opinions that differ. And if you don't believe me, you just ask, you choose 20 different people in the congregation, ask them what they think about wearing masks, and you're going to find a number of different answers. Now, should that divide us? Absolutely not. But it will and can. Things like that surely can. But it's important that we are anchored as a church in the love of Christ. And so he prayed that they would be joined together in love in verse 2. So that they might also gain as a church body all of the riches that God intended for them, and to have the knowledge of God's mystery. You know what the knowledge of God's mystery is? Huh? Jesus Christ. That's exactly right. That word mystery there goes clear back to the Old Testament. Whenever, did any of you manage before things were closed down to see Sight and Sound, Samson? It was a great, one of their great plays. Of course, all their plays are great as they teach things from the Scripture. But that word mystery goes clear back to Judges chapter 13, verse 18. And Manoah, who is Samson's father, asked the angel of the Lord that had come and talked to him about raising his son and not cutting his hair and raising him to be a Nazarite, and that he was going to be a special leader. He asked this angel of the Lord what his name is. And he uses that same word that's used here in the Greek for mystery. He uses that same word in the Hebrew. It translates wonderful. It also translates secret. In other words, the knowledge of God, the secret of knowledge of God's knowledge, the mystery of God's knowledge is in Jesus. It's in Jesus. And so Paul wanted them to be anchored so much in Christ Jesus. And he wanted them to know all the treasures. What the treasures of God are: God's wisdom and his knowledge. Now, you can go in many places to try to seek wise counsel. You can go to many places. You can go to counselors that are called attorneys. You can go to counselors that are psychological counselors. You can go many places. And we need to go to those people on occasions in our life. But I want you to understand that for the church, Jesus is God's answer. In Isaiah chapter 9, when we read about the birth of a new child, we have the name Wonderful Counselor. You see, the treasures that God has for us is his wisdom and his knowledge how to get along in life. Paul wanted that for this church in Colossae. He wanted that for our church here in Oak Grove. He wanted other people literally to be anchored in fully the person of Jesus Christ. Now, in order for us to pray effectively for our leaders tomorrow night, in order for us to effectively help others be anchored in Christ, what needs to happen? We need to be anchored ourselves, don't we? We need to be anchored ourselves in these next verses that really, the heart of the passage, when you go to scripture memory, you usually memorize verse 6 and 7 out of this entire passage. But in this next section of scripture, he encourages this idea of being anchored ourselves. If we're going to help others be anchored, if Paul was going to be effective teaching these churches and these church planters, these leaders, if he was going to be effective praying for them in the confines of the prison, he needed to be anchored in Christ himself. We need to be anchored ourselves. Look at verse 4. I am saying this so that no one will deceive you with persuasive arguments. For I may be absent in the body, but I'm with you in spirit, rejoicing to see your good order and the strength of your faith in Christ. He was encouraged when he looked closely at that church that he was able to see a church who had faith in Christ Jesus, who had anchored themselves in Christ. If you're going to be effective as a partner in the harvest, if you will, and we're all called to be partners in the harvest, we need as individuals to be anchored in Christ. If you're going to go back to the husbands and wives, if you're going to help in your marriage relationship, if you're going to be a help to your mate, you need to be anchored in Christ. We need ourselves to be anchored in Christ Jesus. There are six things that I see in these verses. First, we get our answers in Christ. We do this by studying Jesus and worshiping Jesus. Secondly, we train ourselves not to listen to persuasive arguments. I like good dialogue. I think that is very helpful. I think it's very helpful, especially in doing outreach. And I think it's helpful if we have healthy dialogue where we listen back and forth. I think it's a tremendous way to show that we love each other and we have mutual respect. But the encouragement here is that we not be pulled away by persuasive arguments. But we train ourselves, again, to study Jesus and to worship Jesus. Third thing that I see here is our strength, the strength of our faith comes in Christ. He was touched by the strength of their faith because it came through Jesus Christ. The strength of our faith, it comes through learning to rest in Jesus. I was visiting with one about what real faith was. And as we were talking about some particular dilemmas, I said, you know, faith is not always seen in watching that dilemma gets solved or that problem gets solved. Faith is when we come up to that point and the dilemma's still there, the problem's still there, we're still having to work through it, but faith is whenever we're able to rest in Jesus and say, Jesus, even though I don't have the answer, Jesus, even though I know there are a number of hurdles that I'm not sure I can clear all those hurdles, you're enough. And I can rest in you. You see, the strength of our faith comes in knowing Christ. And you know Christ, again, through much study and worship of him. The fourth thing that I see here is to learn to walk in Christ. And again, our goal is to see those little 10 to 14 month old children or grandchildren learn to walk and to be able to navigate by themselves. Now, if you're like me, once they learned to walk and they got into more stuff, I went around tripping them up, you know, and trying to knock them back down because they were getting into, you know, I couldn't keep up with them quite like I wanted to. Now, the goal is for us to learn to walk, and the goal for ourselves as we would be anchored in Christ is to learn to walk in Christ, rooted and built up in Christ. And every time I've studied this verse, I've always looked at that idea. He says to walk in Christ, but then he immediately says to be rooted and built up in Christ. When I think about being rooted and built up in Christ, we're rooted. That's a stationary thing. That's where we get the idea of being anchored. And yet at the same time, we learn to walk in Christ. Paul knew very well that they were going to have to navigate through this world. This is where we live. This is where we're at. And we have to learn to navigate through this life, this world. Our soul and our spirit that has been born again is veiled in this human flesh, and it lives in this world. We have to have jobs. We have to provide for families. We have to watch our children get educated, and so on and so forth. And so we live in this world. And we need, as we live in this world, learn to walk in Christ Jesus at the same time knowing that he is the anchor that we're rooted in, that holds us, that holds us. And so we have both of those ideas. Number five, established in faith. Established in faith. Now, our strength of faith is Christ Jesus. But when you're established in faith, you learn to, as you navigate and walk in Christ in this world, you learn that by faith we live. That's why we have that wonderful chapter in Hebrews chapter 11 that lists the heroes of faith. And I must say that from time to time, whenever I have the privilege putting together a funeral homily or message for different individuals, I when I look at their life and I've experienced them as a person, I want to go to that chapter and see where their name is listed. Kevin, I looked the other day for Jan's name in the Heroes of Faith because she had learned to walk by faith. She was established by her faith, not by circumstances. You see, circumstances will, you know, that is that ship that doesn't have an anchor. Then it's just kind of floating here and there and willy-nilly. But when we're established in our faith, it is the same. No matter what the circumstance, no matter what's going on in life. And finally, number six, as we're anchored in Christ, to overflow with thankfulness. To overflow with thankfulness. And again, it intrigues me that Paul would be encouraging them to overflow with thankfulness because of his own circumstances. If he was going to encourage them to be thankful, he would have to be thankful himself. And you read the letter that he wrote to the church at Philippi, and you say that, hey, don't despair for me. I'm celebrating. I'm giving thanks because all these people are getting saved, and not only are they getting saved, but they're spreading the gospel message throughout the palace guard. You see, he learned how to give thanks. As we're anchored in Christ, these are just a few of the things that are listed here that are important for our anchor to hold, and that last one being to learn to be thankful in all things. Finally, he just kind of carries it home with this idea of anchor in Christ. Look at verse 8 and 10 as he gives another word of encouragement in this whole lesson. Be careful that no one takes you captive through philosophy and empty deceit based on human tradition, based on the elemental forces of the world and not based on Christ. For in him the entire fullness of God's nature dwells bodily. You have been filled by him who is the head over every ruler and authority. When you're anchored in Christ, when you're anchored in Christ, even those times whenever you don't understand, you know, they came to Jesus one day. Simon Peter came to Jesus and said, well, what about this whole idea of paying taxes? And as Jesus responded to that, so are we supposed to give our allegiance to God or are we supposed to pay taxes? And Jesus answered him by saying, go fishing. I like that answer. Go fishing. And he went out and caught a fish. He said, when you catch that first fish, you take the tax money for us out of his mouth. And he literally took a coin out of the fish's mouth. And he said, now, whose inscription is there? He says, Caesar. He said, render unto Caesar what Caesar's, render unto God what is God. When you're anchored in Christ, there will be surprises all along the way in how he's going to get you through. I am intrigued when you walk with Christ that sometimes you see Christ do things that maybe go against the grain. And you say, you know, what's going on here, Lord? That guy's, he's chalked full of leprosy. Anybody that could look at him can see he has only half a nose and half an ear, and he's got leprosy everywhere. What are you doing reaching out to touch him? Sometimes a person may not need, and don't mistake this at all, but sometimes a person may not need social distancing. They may need a hug. And that guy needed to be healed, and Jesus knew that if he touched him, he would be healed. You see, when you're anchored in Christ, your life is going to be filled with all kinds of surprises along the way and how he manages things. The important thing for us is that we are anchored in him and we're not just rebelliously going our way. I think it's a good idea as we're inside that we wear these masks. I think it's a good idea. I've got a daughter that says, it really does help. And she said, what helps is you don't sneeze on somebody else or you don't spit on somebody else, your germs. That's probably the biggest help. The other part is pretty marginal as far as the research goes. But I think that it's probably a good idea for us to wear these masks. Now, after the election, if that's all solved and they have a big mass burning party, well, I'll be there dropping mine in the fire. I'll promise you. I wonder how Jesus would surprise us. I'm going to say to some of you, he would surprise you at times when he would have the mask on. And then to others of you, he would surprise you when he would have the mask off. Let me tell you something. when you anchor in Christ, and you can start at the beginning of the Gospels and read all the way through, and you can find where Jesus surprised those followers, those disciples, every day, and how he responded to situations. And we don't need to make a religion out of any one given response by Jesus, because the next day he may respond differently. But after all, he's Jesus. He's God. And I only need to be anchored in him. I need to be anchored in him. And when I am, that makes all the difference. Let's pray together. Father, you are the head of the body, the church. You're head of the church at Colossae. You're head of our church. You're my authority. You're my Lord. And I don't have all the answers, but I believe that you are omniscient. You have all knowledge. And the wonderful secret and mystery of life that makes things so exciting lies in you. And I thank you for that. I need your help that my anchor would be solidly tied to you. And that when I'm lacking answers, that you'll give me that peace that assures me you are the answer, regardless of the problem. Lord, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we go to Sunday school, Mr. Stephen's going to come and lead us in our closing prayer. And Steve Mapes is our deacon of the week. So I'm going to give you the microphone. And as you pray, if you'll remember Jackie as well.
Certainly. Okay. Shall we pray together? Heavenly Father, in the sacred name of your Son, Jesus, God, just thank you for each soul that's gathered here today. Thank you, Lord, for each one that, Lord, together we've been able to lift up our voices and just, God, honor you and praise you and just thank you, God, for being our anchor. God, thank you for this message today. And, God, may we remember this throughout the week as we're, Lord, going through our walk that, Lord, you are with us. You're our anchor in these storms of life. God, you're greater than COVID-19. You're greater, Lord, than even what dear Jackie is facing. Lord, and in particular, we would just ask that, Lord, with this ailment that's on her skin, that, God, you would touch her. God, just touch her with her skin that's going on. Lord, as Randy reminded us, you touched the leper. And, Lord, your righteousness and holiness just drove out the disease. We just pray that you would bless her and encourage her and touch her very body. Lord, and bless and encourage us as we're walking through the storms of life this week. God, that we would just know you're our anchor and you are with us. And as Randy said, Lord, we might be reminded that you are enough, God. You're bigger than everything that we face. So God, just bless us this week. Bless our families. Bless our friends. And God, may we remember to have this contagious joy that Paul had, that people might recognize, God, we have a hope, God, in you, Lord, that we might just, Lord, let that joy be contagious, God, despite everything going on. And God, we just rebuke the adversary and everything he's up to, God, in the name of Jesus, and empower us as your children. We thank you for this parting blessing in Jesus' name.